page 206, paragraph 45. Just to review where we are, so that we can get our bearings in the next section of the Kuzari, the Jewish people represent the heart of humanity. We suffer more than the rest of the world because we absorb through assimilation some of the negative things that the world does. God takes that into account, and because we represent the conduit to the divine in this world, we have to be purified immediately. And so we're more sensitive to defect, just like the heart is more sensitive to defect. And whenever there's a slight something that goes awry within the Jewish people, the repercussions are more immediately felt within our community. And that's why the Jews tend to suffer more than other people. So the Kuzari said, and that's really the context that we're up to, is that, you know, sometimes the Jews suffer more than other people. He says, you have commented and analogized amply on this subject, but if you are truly the elite of all people, one would expect to see more people in your ranks serving God through asceticism than any other religion, than in any other religion. Why isn't asceticism and monasticism more emphasized in your faith? Why don't we find that truly righteous Jews are not living in monasteries, acting like monks, and depriving themselves of the basic benefits of life, which seems to be extolled in other religions? Now, where do we get onto this discussion? Well, it's a couple of things. Number one, remember this discussion started with the discussion of Isaiah chapter 53. And what is Isaiah chapter 53? It's the suffering servant. It's a really central text in Christian theology because it describes how suffering in and of itself is a virtuous thing for the true servant or for the true messianic figure, that he suffers on, you know, for our sins. And throughout Christian history, the idea of the passion, of the very, very suffering of Yashka, of the Messiah of the Christians, is in itself considered to be a virtuous thing. Asceticism, personal deprivation, monasticism, whatever you want to call it, depriving oneself of the pleasures of life is viewed as a way of becoming closer to God. You strip yourself, deprive yourself of the physical, and you're able to have a more spiritual leap, a more spiritual connection. And that's something that is emphasized certainly in Christianity. It is not emphasized in Islam, and it is not as emphasized in Judaism. Now, this, you know, so again, we're continuing a little bit of this polemic against Christianity in this passage as well, just like as we did in the Isaiah 53 discussion about the suffering servant. The suffering servant in Isaiah 53 is not Yashka, is not the Christian Savior, but rather it is the Jewish people themselves. And if we want to try and understand a little bit of our theology, why we don't extol the virtue of physical deprivation, then we have to follow along and see, you know, what makes Judaism distinct in its theological approach from Christianity. But at least we understand that there's a certain continuity here. And we also understand why the Khazar king is curious, because he says, I see Christians extolling this virtue. And the more that they're able to deprive themselves, the holier they claim to be. So why is it in Judaism that we don't do that? Now, first of all, let me ask you a question. Is asceticism or monasticism something that is common to Judaism, or is it something that is not common to Judaism? Anyone have any thoughts that they'd like to reflect upon? What is the role of physical deprivation in Jewish living? Can anyone give an example of it? Yes, Nanette.
Well, a nazir, it's not considered to be praiseworthy. It's like, you know, you're bringing a korban at the end of your...
So, right, so perfect. So we have the example of the nazir, right? And so the nazir is a person who takes a vow of temporary asceticism, usually it's temporary, although the Gemara does discuss the possibility of a lifelong nazir, although that's non-normative. A nazir is a person who takes a vow of nazir. It could be a man or a woman, takes a vow of 30 days of some kind of deprivation, not all deprivation, certainly not hitting yourself and not starving yourself and not wearing sackcloth, but at the same time, abstention from wine, letting the hair grow long, not focusing on personal grooming. And as Nanette correctly pointed out, there's at least one opinion in the Gemara that views it as being sinful. But if it is sinful, why then does the Gemara, why does the Torah offer it as an option and consider it a mitzvah for a person to do? Why does the Torah give a person the voluntary option of doing an aveira if it's not something that's virtuous? So what is the view? That sort of that tension between the Gemara on the one hand saying that taking a vow of Nazirism is sinful and therefore a Nazir should bring a sin offering when he's completed with completed his 30-day period of Nazirism versus the whole context of the Nazir, which is, when you look at it in Parshas Naso, in the book of Bamidbar, the mitzvah is situated particularly there because, as the commentaries say, the Torah gives an opportunity for a regular Joe, you know, for just an average guy. He's not a Kohen, he's not a Levi, he's not situated in the camp in anywhere particularly special. And that's actually why it's in Parshas Naso, which talks about the configuration of the camp of Israel in the desert. So when, you know, as the Al-Sheikh says, he says, like, a person's going to read this and they're going to, it talks all about how the Kohanim have a special role, and there's the Mishkan in the center, and the Machane Levi, Moshe, and the Kohanim are all around. And this guy just feels, you know, he feels disenfranchised. He goes, I have nothing special to contribute. So in that context, the Torah says, you can become a Nazir. Every person can be special. Every person can elevate himself in some way. So how do you handle that tension between the Torah seeming to say that there's a virtue to being a Nazir versus the fact that it's also considered to be sinful to be a Nazir because he's deprived himself of the benefits of this world? There's a similar tension that we find that the Gemara tells us a story about Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi, who was the redactor of the Mishnah. He lives sometime in the second century of the Common Era, and the Talmud says two contradictory things about him. It says that on the one hand, he was a man of wealth, a man of means, and therefore, during all seasons of the year, even during the winter season, when fruit and vegetables were not seasonal, he always had the most expensive produce on his table. So this shows a sign of opulence and of indulgence. But on the other hand, the Gemara says a story about Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi that as he was laying on his deathbed, he lifted up his hands to the heaven and he says, I swear to you, Hashem, that not a single finger of all of these 10 fingers ever benefited from this world. So that seems to be a contradiction, does it not? How can you say that a person dined at the finest restaurants during his life and then can say at the end of his life that I never benefited from a single item in this world? And of course, it's a question of attitude. It's a question of why. What was Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi's agenda in having the lavish produce on his table even during the winter months? And as the commentaries tell us, as the Musarists tell us, that if a person indulges in this world not for self-indulgence, but rather to give glory to Hashem, that as the Nasi he felt he had a responsibility to display the royalty of the Jewish people, then he was not indulgent for the indulgence's sake. And that's what he meant when he lifted up his fingers to heaven. And the same attitude, or the same sort of dichotomous, you know, tension-filled attitude is towards physical indulgence. Physical indulgence for the purpose of indulging is considered to be sinful. But by the same token, depriving yourself of physical indulgence is also considered to be sinful. Why? Because you're supposed to have a healthy attitude towards the physical world. The fact that you have to deprive yourself shows that you have an unhealthy attitude to a beautiful world that Hashem gave to you. Hashem put you in this most amazing world. There's colors, there's fragrance, there's taste, and all of these things are such delicious, beautiful gifts that Hashem placed in this world for us. How can we say to God, after He's given us all of these beautiful gifts, say, no thanks, God, I think I'll pass on the gift. But Hashem says, but don't you like what I gave you? Look what I planted for you. Look what I grew for you. Look what I placed in your world. And you're turning it away? That shows me that you don't appreciate all the things that I do for you. So that's why, in a sense, monasticism or asceticism is not considered to be a virtue in Judaism. If we have the proper attitude that Hashem, you gave this to me as a gift so that I could appreciate your world and only proclaim your greatness even more in the universe, that would be the most healthy attitude towards the physical. And the only reason why the Torah gives sanction to a nazir is because a nazir is a perfect example of a person who needs to go on a diet. What is the reason for becoming a nazir? The reason for becoming a nazir is because I've overdone it. I went back too many times for seconds at the buffet table, and I'm paying the consequences now. Now it's time for me to slim down and to shed the pounds. The Torah says there's an accommodation for that. If you feel that you've overindulged in the physical world, and you find that you're preoccupied with what bottle of wine you're going to have for dinner tonight, and you're thinking about that all day, or if you find yourself preoccupied by standing in the mirror for hours and hours every week, and you spend inordinate amounts of time grooming yourself, so then you know there's probably something awry in your value system, and you need to scale it back. And sometimes when you scale back because you've overdone something, so the Rambam tells us, the golden mean is the path in the middle. And if a person finds that he or she has moved over too far, either to the right or to the left of the golden mean, what do you have to do? If you've moved too far in this direction, you have to temporarily go to the opposite direction until you feel healthy enough to go back into the middle. You cannot shift from one extreme to the middle because you'll get pulled back to the extreme. So you have to move from one extreme to the other extreme temporarily until you can find yourself making your way back into the middle and have that healthy attitude once again. And that's why asceticism is only extolled as a temporary measure, as a response to an excess on the other side. But that's why, for that very same reason, it's a mitzvah, but it's also a reflection of a moral failing. Because if I have to utilize that device to get myself back into the middle, then that's in itself a reflection that I've let myself go. Are you with me? You're right? You understand? So it's possible for something to be a mitzvah and an aveira at the same time. It's a mitzvah in the sense that, okay, I've let myself go and I got to become a nazir. But at the same time, the very fact that I declare myself a nazir is a reflection of how I have let myself go. Yes?
Does that apply to an addictive behavior of somebody? Like somebody that they, they have some behavior and they just...
It applies to all addictive behavior. I mean, after all, anything that is against Hashem's will as for our behavior as moral human beings is considered to be addictive behavior in one sense or another, whether it's gluttony or whether it's addiction to gambling, addiction to other, physical intimacy, pornography, drugs, alcohol. People can get addicted to their crackberry, as they call it, their iPhone. Yeah, people can get addicted to a lot of different things. Any kind of behavior that pulls away to what you intuit, based upon what the Torah tells us, and based upon what you know is right for you. If you intuit that I'm overindulging in something, that I know is not healthy for me, that's called an addiction. So I don't mean to, you know, just casually throw around the term addiction. There are people who are clinically addicted to substances, and that's a different type of addiction that has to be addressed in a different way. But, you know, look, it's great for people who are addicted to enter into a 12-step program. That's like a form of naziris. But it would be much better for a person never to have to had to enter into a 12-step program in the first place. Because if you were healthy from the very start, you never would have been, and you never had become an addict, so then the 12-step program would not have been necessary. So certainly that's not what a person who's currently in a 12-step program needs to hear. We shouldn't be castigating the person who's in recovery and telling him what a terrible person you are that you had to go into recovery. That's not what that person wants to hear or should be hearing. They need to hear words of encouragement. But at the same time, if we wanted to reflect upon the whole Jewish attitude towards abstention and asceticism, the correct attitude is be healthy and follow the golden mean in life when it comes to anything. Don't take anything too extreme. And then you'll never have to go into a recovery program. But it doesn't always work that way. See, what we've done, unfortunately, in modern society is that we've told ourselves that you can have everything you want. You can have it all. And once we've been told that we can have it all, that leads to excess. It leads to excessive behavior. It leads to overindulgence. And then we end up paying the price afterwards. And we have to go into the other direction. We all have to become nazirim. But abstention or asceticism for the sake qua abstention is not a virtue. It's not considered to be a virtue, unlike Christianity, which says that the very fact that Yashka suffered on the cross means that there's also this virtue of suffering for the sake of suffering so that we can all become closer to God. So that's not the emphasis. When we fast, for example, on a fast day, there is that idea of temporary deprivation for the sake of helping to get ourselves on a temporary basis removed from the physical so that we can temporarily detach ourselves from the physical world and devote ourselves to Hashem. But it's a very, very small component of the daily life of a Jew. And as a matter of fact, voluntary fasting is frowned upon as well. Because voluntary fasting is that very same issue. It's a sign of an unhealthy attitude towards the physical world. So that would be sort of the answer that we would expect to be given to the Kuzari. He says, well, if you're such a holy people, then why don't the righteous, why aren't your tzaddikim fasting and living in monasteries? Okay? So, yes, Patricia.
I know from my husband's family in Tripolitania, that it was considered virtuous to fast on Mondays and Thursdays.
Right.
Where did that come from?
Well, Mondays and Thursdays, it wasn't minhag in Europe to fast on Mondays and Thursdays among very pious people. Certainly that's not our goal, is to cast aspersions on any minhag that is done by holy people. There are sects of ascetics within the Jewish people, and it is discussed in the Holy Sfarim. There are passages in the words of Chazal and in later passages that indicate that self-flagellation is virtuous, but it's only virtuous in the context of I've gone into something unhealthy and I need to deprive myself in order to get myself back on track. That's the only thing that I want. That's the only way to contextualize it. I have to be honest, many people in Europe fasted on Mondays and Thursdays to provide for their families. In other words, there simply wasn't enough food to go around.
That crossed my mind.
There simply wasn't enough food, and as a way of expression of righteousness, I know that my kids and the rest of the members of my family need food, so I will deprive myself so that they can have more. That is a sense of self-sacrifice, which is virtuous because there just isn't simply not enough to go around. And Monday and Thursday came up because, you know, Monday and Thursday, it's sufficiently after Shabbos. You've, you know, you're still digesting the cholent on Monday. And on Thursday, you're getting ready to eat again for Erev Shabbos. So that would...
Nothing to do with the Torah reading days?
Well, it could be. It could be. Everything is spaced properly. You know, from Shabbos to Shabbos, there's 6 days. You know, 6 days in between every Shabbos. And so Monday and Thursday are correctly spaced, you know, approximately, properly, and that's the same reason for Torah reading, spacing the spiritual injections that we need over the course of the week. Monday and Thursday gives us that proper spacing. Okay, so let's see if the rabbi has an answer to the Kuzari's challenge of why righteous Jews don't deprive themselves more. So the rabbi said, I am pained by the fact that you have forgotten what I explained earlier, to which you also agreed. Did we not agree that one cannot become close to Hashem except through the commandments of Hashem? Do you now think that closeness comes simply through humility, lowliness, and the like? So before we get to the Kuzari's response, which is, yeah, that's what I think, what is the rabbi's objection to the Khazar king? The rabbi says, listen, we've had this conversation already. Don't you remember we talked about back in the first essay, we talked about how the pathway to divine closeness is not through what you think is correct. The pathway to divine closeness is what Hashem tells us is correct. So no individual human can possibly intuit using their intellect alone the best way to become close to Hashem. And that's one of the big mistakes that people have made throughout history. And that's how idolatry gets started, and that's how all other religious sects become started, is that someone has a great idea. He says, listen, wouldn't it be great, you know, if I climbed to the top of a mountain and I stripped myself bare and I put myself on a cross or I did some other kind of thing and I said, God, I'm yours, right? And I totally dedicate myself to God. Well, that sounds like a good idea until the guy gets struck by lightning, right? And then doesn't work. So then someone else tries something. So there's, in other words, there's always a good idea that a person can have. Gee, this sounds great. This sounds like the best way for me to possibly get close to God. But ultimately, you remember the analogy that Rabbi Yehuda Halevi had given us about the fellow who walks into the medical clinic and doesn't know about medicine at all? But he just has seen it one day. He was walking by the clinic when it was open, and he saw it was a dispensary, and he saw that the physician, there was a line of people, and the physician would listen to the people's problem, and he would give them a little bottle of something and send them on their way. So he figured, that doesn't look hard. I can do that. So when the physician's on vacation, he opens the doors of the dispensary, puts on the doctor's hat, and people line up, and he says, well, tell me what your problem is. And he says, okay, take a little bottle of this or take a little bottle of that, without knowing at all how the medicine interacts with the person, not knowing at all anything about medicine, and he ends up killing most of his patients, or certainly not healing any of them. And maybe one person he got lucky with and gave the insulin to the diabetic, right, in the proper dosage. But that would be like 1 out of 100 that he got lucky with, right? So he says, that's what other religious observances are like. He says, unless Hashem tells us what he expects of us to do, there's really no way for us to know accurately what Hashem expects of the human being. Now, we're going to see a little pushback from the Khazar king in just a moment, because the Khazar king tends to think that asceticism is a virtue. It's a human virtue. And, you know, so don't tell me that, you know, oh, you have to wait for God to give you instructions. Do you need to wait for God to tell you not to murder someone? Do you need to wait for God to tell you not to steal? But this, at least at face value, is the initial answer of the rabbi. He says, listen, don't try to make up your own religious virtuous observances. Don't tell me that monasticism, living in a monastery wearing a potato sack, is something virtuous, you know? You know that story about the nun who came to the monastery? You know, and because she wanted to see how the monks lived? And they welcome her in, and they sit her down, and they give her a dinner, and it's the most delicious fish and chips she's ever had in her entire life. And she is so impressed, because these are monastics, you know, they're monks, so of course, you know, they're not used to good food, but it's the most delicious food she's ever had. So she says, I must meet the chef, please, I'd like to give him my compliments. And so they say, come into the kitchen. And there's two monks over there, and she goes over to the first monk, Brother Michael, and she says, this dinner was delicious. He says, well, I didn't make all of it, I'm just the fish fryer. Are you with me yet? The fish fryer. But then she turns to the second monk and she says, you must be, he says, yes, the chip monk. But anyway, I digress. Sorry about that. Anyway. Yes, sorry.
What about the idea that some rabbis have that sometimes God sends you like a bad sickness so that you'll call out to him and you'll get closer to him?
That doesn't negate, I mean, that's a different theological principle. That's a principle that Hashem does send us messages constantly. And we have to be aware, of our surroundings and try and look for those messages. It's true that we believe that Hashem rewards the righteous and punishes the wicked, and therefore if the Gemara itself says, if a person sees things happening in his or her life that seem to be a sign of something bad, then yifashfesh b'ma'asav, you should examine your ways. But that doesn't mean that doesn't relate to what we're talking about now, which is self-deprivation, right? In other words, we're not advocating. If a person feels that, you know, maybe God's sending me a message that I'm not doing something right, then don't start making up your own religious practice of self-deprivation. The proper thing to do is, what am I doing wrong? Let me go through my daily routine. Let me compare that to what the Shulchan Aruch says that how a Jew is supposed to live his or her life. And let me see if I'm being consistent. Is my davening a correct davening? Is my Shabbos observance a correct Shabbos observance? Is the way that I speak to other people, am I speaking Lashon Hara? Am I not speaking Lashon Hara? Am I fulfilling Ben Adam Lachaver or Ben Adam Lamakom? Let me think about what am I doing right, what am I doing wrong? That's what you're talking about. Yeah? Okay. Okay, let's hold it here from the Kuzari. We'll continue this discussion with Kuzari's objection, saying, yeah, I do think that I have a right to say that asceticism is a virtuous behavior, even without God waiting for God to tell me, but we'll get to that next time.